class. No, you're right. Joe Strummer talking with me, Sylvia Amorito, on KNAC. Joe, once again, thanks for talking with us.
That's great. My privilege.
Well, thank you. A couple things. First of all, you're pleased about the changes, then, in the band.
Yeah, it's time, you know, time to rediscover what we set out to do. When I say we got lost, I mean it, you know, and it come on, everybody should come out and admit their mistakes and get on with it, rather than trying to cover it up. I just think we got fooled by the industry, and I'd like to give a message out to young musicians that you have to really hang on to what you want to do. And there's so many people trying to, like, producers, agents, managers, record people, they're all trying to back you off what you want to do, unless you got to stick to it like as if you were a fanatic, you know? If I can give any indication on that score, I'll be happy.
Well, good. There's a bit of good advice from Joe Strummer. But don't forget, the Clash will be at the Long Beach Arena tonight.
Yeah,
good
point, Sylvia. We're at the Long Beach Arena tonight, you know, and I want to see some people there. I want to feel that I'm not shouting into an empty eggshell, you know. I want to feel like there's people out there. I mean, I'm not sure there's anyone in Long Beach who's going to fill that place, you know. So I want some help here.
Oh, he wants some bodies in there. And there will be, I'm sure of that. The Us Festival.
Yeah, the Us Festival.
Back in 83, good old Us Festival.
Yeah, I tell you, if it wasn't for us, I mean Clash, everyone would have forgotten about the Us Festival because it would have been so boring.
Do you feel that your press conference prior to the Us Festival helped you accomplish what you wanted to do?
Well, I'm not sure if we knew what we wanted to do, but you see, all we wanted to achieve was one thing. We wanted to go in and point out that you can't have unity when there is nothing to unify around.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think they were trying to get away with a nice headline, a nice banner, and without really backing it up. You know, really, let's be truthful, it was a merchandising occasion.
So
you know, they were selling beer, they were selling computers, they were selling T-shirts, and there was a few groups being put on in a field at the back. I mean, really, it was a merchandising affair. And, like, we didn't like, you know, I'm going to go and be there because I want Rebel Music to be bigger than Van Halen and David Bowie, you know? And if you think the Clash ain't going to headline a three-day rock gig direct competition with the Halen and Bowie, you're wrong. You know, we've got to go in there and do that.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, we're being condemned to the smug purist. Oh, aren't they roots? They play at clubs that only 10 people can get in. Isn't that wonderful? And all that stuff. You know, I think that's ghettoology, and I'm not having it. And, you know, if Steve Wozniak from Apple Corporation wanted to restage Woodstock for the benefit of his nostalgic feelings, let him. But let's not have any nonsense that it's unity or unison or whatever that was.
Without having it there.
Yeah, I mean, he fired everybody in his organization directly after the event anyway, so who was right in the end? And I just felt we had to go in there and we had to spoil the hippie party, if you like. You know, we had to be the lousy limeys bratting around. I don't mind if, you know.
Well, you did. You got some slack for that.
Yeah, I know.
You know?
I'm glad. I mean, I can take it, you know, and I put myself up for it, and
well,
I can take it.
You know,
and I think what's really wrong is that, you know, Clash put up a high standard. We want to play intense, and we want to do things to a high standard. But how come I want to be judged by my own standards, but I want Van Halen to be judged by them. I want every lousy group that ever squeezed a platinum record out onto the floor to be judged by them. But, oh, no, you know, let them all walk off with three times as much money and having set the world back another 10 years, you know.
Yeah.
I'm just bored with it. I'll go and brat around anywhere and scream anything just to get some reaction from people. At least people were talking to each other, you know, instead of going home and watching the damn television.
Well, while you were getting a little bit of slack, people failed to realize, too, that you do things for people, as such as you've done a 26-mile run for a leukemia benefit in England. And,
you
trained for that, stopped drinking, stopped doing everything just to get...
Yeah, I'll tell you what I'm trying to do. Like, I'm trying to say, like, it's over the glamorous, stumbling, foolish rock and roll. Oh, it's over all that. Oh, isn't he wasted? Isn't he wonderful? Oh,
mm-hmm.
How thrilling. All that, you know, grandmother stuff. Go and do the knitting if you're really into all that, you know. All that's over and finished and gone, you know. I think you can be fit and rocking and do a much more intense concert than some drugged-up fool who can't even tune a guitar.
Well, you've got
you know,
to...
I think all that's finished and gone, you know. Bury the Keith Richards lookalikes, you know. Bury all that stuff. You know, the junkies on the street, they got sold that myth through rock and roll. And it's time to say drugs are finished and boring and for hippies only. All hippies take drugs and all drug takers are hippies. Amen.
We're going to do another song from the Clash, Joe. This is London Calling on Rock and Rhythm 105.5 KNAC.
Okay.
KNAC Long Beach. Sylvia Amorito talking with Joe Strummer of The Clash. You founded the group, didn't you, Joe?
Yeah, I was in it from the start, you know. And what's more, I've got a memory on me, you know. I feel like a limey, you know, coming over here and shouting his mouth off, and I feel like people go, why doesn't that limey just shut up and go home? You know, I understand that, and it's a good point. But see, the thing is, I've got a good memory, and I can remember when I was at school reading about the civil rights movement and the anti-war movement and all the marches on the streets in Chicago in 68, and I know that people can't remember that anymore. Mm-hmm. It's all got lost in a haze of marijuana fog, you know? And like, all we're trying to do in The Clash is say, look, the music was directly tied to that kind of feeling. Let's get the music back on its feet and then get hold of the social situation and get that back on its feet. You know, I'm only urging the world to take on structures that care for other people, like the poor and the sick and the mentally ill, all the people that...
This one has nothing to do with boundaries.
Yeah, all the poor people that the capitalist system can't... Because they're so busy winding us all up into supporting armies and nuclear bombs and weapons. You know, all the money is going on that stuff, and it's been wasted, you know. Why defend the country if there's nothing here worth defending? You know, let's put it back into where it should be. It's all a wind-up. And, like, all we're trying to do is to set the music back on its feet. We're trying to provide an example so that young groups don't have to say, oh, I get it, we have to... Be a music business on a leash and wear makeup and a dress and just poof around and write sort of inconsequential lyrics and rubbishy, lightweight, fake black music pop songs. You know, I don't want young people to be thinking like that. I want them to be thinking, hey, I'm alive. I'm an actual human being. You know, that's what I want young people to think. I can say what I mean and feel what I say. You know, I don't want it to feel... I feel like the music business has got the whole, every bit of music locked up tight in their palm, and they don't want to let it go. They don't want anyone upsetting the apple cart. And it's going to destroy everything eventually because it's so safe. And so accountants and lawyers are writing the songs. You know, attorneys are playing the lead guitar solos. Soon, you know, musicians won't even be allowed to sweep up the street outside the studios if they don't watch out.
You know, in the book 1988, The Punk Rock Explosion by Carolyn Kuhn, you mentioned that you wanted to start a radio station with some of your money.
Yeah.
What do you think?
Well, we tried this. See, in London, they tell us you can have two stations, and all the rest of the frequency has got to be used up for the ambulance network or the fire brigade. You know? And I go to New York and the dial is jammed. I come to LA and the dial is jammed. I go to Paris and the dial is jammed. You know, what a country. So we've got a really healthy pirate radio stuff, you know? And we shoot money into some of them pirate radio stations. And Paul Simonon made up a tape that we put out on the air. You know, we're doing something over there with that. Because what they do is they spend a lot of money in the post office going around with transmitter vans, ripping off all the pirate radio gear, smashing it up and finding the people. So we've helped to replace some of that gear. But it's just another instance of what a con, how... You know, meanwhile, everybody in London is sitting there going, oh, okay, well, two stations, all right, we get it.
Oh, then they just accept it.
Yeah, I mean, everything is being accepted.
We're going to do a song right now, Joe, White Riot. This is one of the earlier singles from The Clash, right?
Tee hee hee.
Yeah, well, let's do it. White Riot on Rockin' Rhythm 105.5 KNAC. We'll be right back.
face.
Okay, you're talking with Joe Strummer of The Clash. Yes, we're talking about the music playing, didn't we? Okay, well, that's all right. Joe Strummer, having to get back to rehearsal in just a few minutes, I know, to get ready for tonight's show at the Long Beach Arena, The Clash in concert, the only Southern California appearance. And I would say get down, see the new members of the band, and experience The Clash firsthand. If you haven't already, then what are you waiting for? If you have, then you know you'll be there tonight at the Long Beach Arena, that's for sure. Right, Joe?
You bet. I want people there, you know. Give it a chance. Give it a whirl, because everything else is getting really boring.
You know, we've mentioned some of the band, you know, the bands, the Van Halen bit and all that other stuff. But when you toured with The Who, they reportedly said that they were really knocked out to have you along. Did you have mutual feelings on that?
No, well, I just, look, you know, I'll speak honestly, right? I like Pete Townsend and all that, and it was nice of them to take us on their 8 gigs of this multi-stadium tour, right?
Yeah.
But the fact is, I looked at them and I thought, is this really the end of the road? You know, four geezers who just about can put up with each other in the same room for 10 minutes and then go on stage and run through their hits. I mean, I just thought, is this it? You know, and they're not really feeling that much from the audience or getting any communication going. I just felt like, surely that, if that's where it's going, you know, I'm going to become a vet or a tree surgeon or a mushroom farmer or a scuba diver, you know, anything rather than that. And that's another reason why we had to reorganize the band and kick people out and move people in, because, you know, I want to honestly feel like I'm friends with the guys on the team, and we all pull together, and it's not just for an hour in the spotlight so we fool the rest of the world that we can sing in harmony and twang our guitars to a gentle beat, you know. Give over. I want to really feel the spirit of a team as a reality, you know. I don't want to deal in fake plasticness, and I just, you know, I like Pete Townsend and The Who are pretty decent geezers individually, but as a thing, you know, you can see why they split it up and dumped it, because it was just becoming, you know, I think that was an honest move on their part.
Yeah. Listen, Pete. Got all into the
Pete Townsend. I'm whirling the phone around now, the room. Quang, quang, wah, wah, wah.
Really angry. Listen, Joe. I tell you what, I know you have to get back to rehearsal and get ready for tonight's show. So before I keep you too long on the phone and, you know, do that type of bit to the show tonight, make it my fault, I'll tell you what, we're going to give away 10 pairs of tickets, by the way, to see your show tonight. So there'll be lots of folks from KNAC that will be supporting you.
So there'll be 10 people there at least, right? Great.
Minimum.
Great. The news is good.
Listen, so I'll tell you, before we relinquish the line, the first 10 callers through to 437-KNAC, you've got the tickets tonight to the show. Joe Strummer from The Clash, you've done quite a bit with your career, and outspoken though you may be, the things that you say are very important, and I think the things that you say need to be said, so thank you so much for
that. All right, Sylvia, rock on, huh?
We'll do. We're going to wrap it up with Police on My Back.
Okay.
Should I stay or should I go now?
Hey there, that's the Joe Strummer interview, one of my favorite celebrity interviews. He was just so easy to talk to and spot on about the music biz. And then seeing The Clash later that night, wow, amazing. Well, listen, like, subscribe, and ring that bell so you know when we upload more of these very cool interviews from my days at 105.5 KNAC and KBIG 104 Los Angeles. Thanks a bunch for listening, and in the words of Joe Strummer, rock on. See ya.
AudioGirlProductions.com.